First of all, let me say that I am delighted to be back home at Harvard. I'm also somewhat petrified at the grandeur of the poetic chair I'm occupying, a chair which has over the years grown into something more like a throne, owing to the long list of eminent persons who have occupied it. It's a tough act to follow, but I am comforted by the sense of having come home again and happy to be realizing my old student fantasy of what it's like to be on the other side of the desk. Now that I am on this side of the desk, all I seem to be able to think about is how it felt to be on that side. It felt good, if you want to know the truth, those 30-odd years ago, mainly because I was very lucky in my masters, Piston and Merritt in music, Kittredge and Spencer in literature, Demos and Hocking in philosophy. But there was one master who bridged it all for me, through whom the sense of beauty, analytic method, and historical perspective all came together in one luminous revelation. And I would like to dedicate these six lectures to his memory. He was Professor David Prawl of the philosophy department, a brilliant scholar and a deeply sensitive aesthetician. It was in this now disdained and rather unfashionable field of aesthetics that I learned from him not only a great deal about the philosophy of beauty, but also the fact that David Prawl was himself an instance of the beauty he loved in mind, heart, and spirit. Those are terribly old-fashioned words in these days of behavioristic obsessiveness, and I hope you will pardon such ancient words as mind, heart, and spirit, especially since I believe in them as strongly now as I did then. Perhaps the principal thing I absorbed from Professor Prawl and from Harvard in general was the interdisciplinary spirit, that the best way to know a thing is in the context of another discipline. So these lectures are given in that spirit of cross disciplines, which is why I'll be speaking of music along with quixotic forays into such fields as poetry, linguistics, aesthetics, and even, heaven help us, a bit of elementary physics. The title of this lecture series is borrowed from Charles Ives, who wrote that brief but remarkable piece of his called The Unanswered Question way back in 1908. Ives had a highly metaphysical question in mind, but I've always felt he was also asking another question, a purely musical one. Whither music? As that question must have been asked by musical man entering the 20th century. Today, with that century 65 years older, we're still asking it. Only it's not quite the same question as it was then. And so the purpose of these six lectures is not so much to answer the question as to understand it, to redefine it. Even to guess at the answer to whither music, we must first ask whence music. What music? Whose music? It would be pretentious to assume that by the end of this series we will answer the ultimate question, but it's reasonable to assume that we'll be in a better position to make some educated guesses. Let me start with a particularly nostalgic and vivid recollection from my years with Professor Prawl. The time back in 1937 when I first heard a recording of Aaron Copland's Piano Variations. I fell in love with the music. It seemed so fierce and poetic and utterly new. This music opened up new worlds of musical possibilities to me, and I wrote a raving report on it for my aesthetics course, and Professor Prawl became so interested in it that he decided he wanted to learn it himself. What a man. He even bought me the sheet music. So I learned it and taught it to him, and he taught it back to me, and we analyzed it together. It became our song. Now, this is not just a sentimental anecdote, because as we were analyzing the Copland Variations, I made a startling discovery that the first four notes of the piece, which are the germ of the whole composition, are really these four notes. The fourth note an octave higher. And I suddenly perceived that these same four notes, in another order, formed the subject of Bach's C-sharp minor fugue from the Well-Tempered Clavichord. And then I discovered the same four notes, transposed, with the first note repeated, germinating the variations in Stravinsky's octet. And the same four notes then popped up in yet another order and key as the initial motto of Ravel's Spanish Rhapsody. And on top of all that, I suddenly recalled some Hindu music I had heard. I was a big Oriental music buff at the time. And there were those same four notes again. Bang, bang. And at that moment, a notion was born in my brain that there must be some deep, primal reason why these discrete structures of the same four notes should be at the very heart of such disparate musics as those of Bach, Copland, Stravinsky, Ravel, and the Uday Shankar Dance Company. And all this and more I poured out to David Prawl, and that was my first Norton lecture to an audience of one. Well, from that time to this, the notion of a worldwide inborn musical grammar has haunted me. But I would never have dreamed of basing a lecture series on a notion so ill-defined and apparently non-verifiable if it were not for the extraordinary materials that have appeared in recent years on the similar idea of a universal grammar underlying human speech. I've been profoundly impressed and encouraged by the burgeoning of thought in this relatively new linguistic area, an area that might be called Chomskyan. By so naming it, I don't mean to restrict my observations to Noam Chomsky's work alone. It's a term of convenience, since he is the best known, most revolutionary, and best publicized name in that area. Along with his colleagues and disciples, many of whom are now in radical disagreement with him, he has produced a body of work that has reinvigorated linguistics to a point where it seems new light may be shed on the nature and structural functions of that elusive thing called mind. In other words, by studying in depth why we talk the way we do, by abstracting the logical principles of language, we may be in a position to discover how we communicate in a larger sense through music, through the arts in general, and ultimately through all our societal behavior. We may even discover how we are mentally constituted, because language is species specific. That is, it's common to all of us who belong to the human species, and only to us. Of course, tomorrow morning, cheerful new facts about dolphins or a certain chimpanzee named Sarah may throw a monkey wrench into the works, but meanwhile, this philosophical science called linguistics seems to have become our newest key to self-discovery. With each passing year, it seems to substantiate ever more convincingly the hypothesis of innate grammatical competence, as Chomsky calls it, genetically endowed language faculty, which is universal. It's a human endowment. It proclaims the autonomy of the human spirit. Well, so does music. But how do we investigate musical universality by so scientific a means as linguistic analogy? Music is supposed to be a metaphorical phenomenon, some kind of mysterious symbolization of our innermost affective existence. It lends itself more easily to description in purple prose than in equations. And even so great a scientist as Einstein said that the most beautiful experience we can have is the mysterious. Of course, he played the fiddle and he loved music. But then why do so many of us constantly try to explain the beauty of music, thus apparently depriving it of its mystery? The fact is that music is not only a mysterious and metaphorical art, it is also in itself a science. It is made of mathematically measurable elements, frequencies, durations, decibels, intervals. And so any explication of music must combine mathematics with aesthetics, just as linguistics combines mathematics with philosophy or sociology or whatever. It is precisely for this interdisciplinary reason that I am so attracted by the new linguistics as a fresh approach to music. Why not a study of musicolinguistics, just as there already exists a psycholinguistics and a sociolinguistics? All right, let's try it. Luckily, the study of linguistics is a threefold science, and so provides us with three handy categories in which these lectures can be conceived. One, phonology, two, syntax, and three, semantics. Phonology, syntax, semantics. These are the three departments of linguistics, and they point the way for our musical investigation as well. In this first lecture, we'll be oriented phonologically, examining both language and music from the most fundamental point of view, that of sound itself, the stuff of which verbal and musical utterances are made. And that should give us a solid base to build on so that in our next session, we can plunge into syntax, the actual structures that arise from that phonological stuff. From then on, the remaining four lectures will confront the challenges of semantics, that is, meaning, both musical and extra-musical meaning. Semantics can be seen as the natural result of adding phonology and syntax together, sound plus structure. And the resultant semantic inquiry will inevitably bring us around back to Ives' unanswered question, whither music in our time? Well, now you can see why I became so excited when I began reading the new linguistics, which postulated the notion of innate grammatical competence, because suddenly my old undergraduate notion of a universal musical grammar was reanimated. It had lain dormant for years, paralyzed, I suppose, by that deadly cliché, music is the universal language of mankind. After 1,000 repetitions of that one, usually with the connotation, support your local symphony orchestra, the well-meant phrase becomes not only a cliché, but a misleading one. How many of you can listen to 40 minutes of a Hindu raga with intelligent comprehension, to say nothing of merely staying awake? And how about certain kinds of avant-garde music? Not so universal, are they? Well, thought I, so much for the universal language of mankind. But then, when I began reading the new linguistics, I thought, here's a fresh way to pursue my intuitive idea, which had grown stale and deteriorated into a platitude. In other words, by building analogies between musical and linguistic procedures, couldn't that cliche about the universal language be debunked or confirmed, or at least clarified? Okay, let's clarify. Universality is a big word and a dangerous one. At the same time that it implies likeness, it also implies diversity. Remember Montaigne's remark that the most universal quality of man is his diversity. Now, this paradox lies at the very heart of linguistic study, because at the same time that a linguist is investigating any one particular language or even a family of languages, trying to formulate a descriptive grammar, he is also searching for the underlying similarities among different languages or families of languages. At least the new linguists are. They construct these descriptive grammars by analyzing the mental processes of human speech, thus deriving sets of rules that hopefully apply to all human languages. In fact, to all possible human languages, both known and unknown. Now, that's a tall order, but a magnificent goal, requiring an inspired guess, a great scientific leap of the mind. And if that goal can be attained, and the universality principle proved, it can turn out to be a timely and welcome affirmation of human brotherhood. But how do linguists go about such a task? Well, one way is by seeking out what they call substantive universals. For example, in the realm of phonology, which is our main concern in this lecture, Linguists propose a substantive universal which says the following: all languages share certain phonemes in common, that is, minimal speech units that arise naturally from the physiological structure of our mouths, throats, and noses. Since we all share those features, we share likewise the sound ah, for instance, a sound produced by simply opening the mouth and vocalizing. Ah. Every normal human being can do this in any language. There is simply no exception, even though the vowel may vary according to the shape of the oral cavity or according to one's social background, producing such variants as class and class and class. But they are all versions of the same phoneme, a, and so must be considered universal. Now that's a substantive universal for you. Other linguists, of course I'm skipping enormous numbers of other substantive universals and distinctive features, and I don't want to burden you with all that. But certain other linguists go about seeking universals in different ways, such as etymologists, who point out that the interesting thing about the Spanish word hablar, to speak, and the Portuguese equivalent falar, to speak, is not that they seem to be totally different words, but that they are the same word, deriving from the same Latin root, fabulare, but with phonetic deviations. Now, let's not go into why they deviated, though it's a fascinating subject. Let's agree only about the common origin. There's the key, common origin. Because if one continues in this way, working backwards through history in search of even earlier common origins, one arrives at startling points of universality. Only such investigation has to stop short as soon as written languages run out. Because obviously, the ultimate evidence of universality in speech is to be sought in the oldest languages of man, prehistoric languages which preceded, so to speak, the Tower of Babel moment in human evolution. But such ancient languages simply don't exist. They were spoken millions of years ago, long before written languages were developed, which was only thousands of years ago. And so, being stuck without written evidence, historical linguists are forced into speculation. Ideally, what they are seeking is a parent language, one universal tongue that may have been common to all of early mankind. And that's the tallest order of all, because it means wandering in the mists of prehistory. One tangible accomplishment, at least, has been to find a name for this field of inquiry, and that name is monogenesis, denoting the theory of all languages springing from a single source. A fine word, monogenesis, and a thrilling idea. It thrills me, anyway, to the point where I stayed up all of one night making monogenetic speculations of my own. I tried to imagine myself a hominid and tried to feel what a very, very ancient ancestor of mine might have felt and might have been impelled to express verbally. I scribbled pages full of basic monosyllables, which felt somehow right, which seemed to belong together, and which delighted me with their curious logic. I began by imagining myself a hominid infant, just lying there, contentedly trying out my newfound voice. And then I got hungry, calling my mother's attention to my hunger. And as I opened my mouth to receive the nipple, lo, I had invented a primal word, ma, mother. Now, this has got to be one of the first proto-words ever uttered by man. Still to this day, most languages have a word for mother that employs that root, ma, or some phonetic variant of it. All the Romance languages, mater, madre, mère, so on, the Germanic, mutter, moder, the Slavic, mat, matka, the Hebrew, ima, Navajo, even Navajo, shima, even Swahili and Japanese and Chinese, they call her mama. Well, that was a small triumph, but then I began expanding. What about ma plus l, say, mal? Now there's a proto-syllable for you. And my first association, of course, was with all the familiar words connoting badness: malo, male, mauvais, all Latin-derived languages, of course. But then I thought, in the Slavic family of languages, that syllable connotes smallness: mali, malinki, and so on. Sudden hypothesis: could there just possibly be a monogenetic connection way back then between the concepts of badness and smallness? Why not? Remember, we're being hominids now, and it's perfectly conceivable that what's small must be automatically bad. To be small is to be weak, to be only human, as against the powerful gods, as against a huge magical earth and sky. Hence, weakness is undesirable, hence bad. It's bad to have a small harvest, small energy, small stature, small dinner. Malo. Well, then, I thought, if that's true, then big must equal good. There must be a corresponding kinship between bigness and goodness. So on I went, searching through all the dictionaries I could find, and what do you think? I found it. Look, the most familiar root denoting bigness is GR, grr, the growling of the big tiger, producing all those big words: grande, grandir, gross, great, grow, and even including groot in Dutch, where the G is softened to a guttural H. Now, these are all Latin and Germanic, but again, look at the Slavic, where again the G is gutturalized to H, and behold the glorious word хороший, which means so inevitably and comfortingly good. And храбрый is brave, and big, brave, good, and God. Somehow it all adds up. Way back, before and behind and beyond all these comparatively recent languages, there must lurk, I fondly hoped, one universal parent tongue which contains the great simultaneous equation: big equals good and small equals bad. Triumph. But why am I burdening you with my private game playing, this less than scientific speculation? It's hardly what a linguist would call authentic. And I cannot say strongly enough that I claim the right to be wrong. It's every teacher's academic right, and I stand ready to take the risk involved, just as any theorist or scientist does. And so my monogenetic speculation interests me, and I hope you, because of what it suggests about music, the origins of music and the very nature of musical materials, the notes themselves. Let's make a simple analogy and return for a second to being that hominid infant who invented the proto-word ma. Well, we quickly learn to associate that morpheme with our supplier of milk, right? And so we call her when we need her: ma! Now, on a purely phonological level, that sound begins with an attack, an ictus, ma, and ends in a descending glide, ma. That's the way we speak: ictus plus glide. Of course, the glide may also be upward if the intention is interrogative: ma. But now let's feel a tremendous intensification of our need, of our hunger, of our impatience. And so we intensify the ictus by prolonging it: ma, and lo and behold, we are singing. Music is born. The syllable has become a note: ma, just eliminating the glide. Or, to use the technical jargon of our time, the morpheme is rewritten as a pitch event. And what an event that must have been way back then. But what we seem to be getting to is a hypothesis that would confirm another famous cliché, namely, music is heightened speech. After all, what causes such a heightening? Intensified emotions, hunger, impatience. And certainly the deepest universals we all share are emotions, affects. We all have the same capacity for passion, fear, anticipation, aggression. We all display the same physiological manifestations of affect. Our eyebrows go up with anticipation, our hearts pound with passion, and fear affects us universally with goose flesh. And in the sense that music may express those affective goings-on, then it must indeed be a universal language. Maybe even a divine one, to invoke yet another cliché. I have often thought that if it's literally true that in the beginning was the word, then it must have been a sung word. The Bible tells us the whole creation story, not only verbally, but in terms of verbal creation. God said, let there be light. God said, let there be a firmament. He created verbally. Now, can you imagine God saying, just like that, let there be light, as if ordering lunch, or even in the original language, yehi or, yehi or. I've always had a private fantasy of God singing those two blazing words, yehi or. Now that could really have done it. Music could have caused light to break forth. But all I've just done is to prolong the ictus again. What I've created is simply heightened speech, which would seem to corroborate yet another cliche about music beginning where language leaves off. I think Schopenhauer, that one. In other words, if the theory of monogenesis is valid, and speech indeed has common origins, and if the heightening of that speech produces music, then music may also be said to have common origins and is therefore universal, whether the notes issue from the mouth of God or from that hungry infant. But where do these notes come from? Why do our ears select certain notes and not others? For example, why do children tease one another in a specific sing-song way? Na, 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 na. Two very special notes, which children also use to call one another, Jerry, Doris, whatever, and which are often used by them in their singing games. Little Sally Water. Now that's the same two notes, only now expanded to three notes. Little Sally Water. Or perhaps you once yelled, Ollie, Ollie, Imfree. Does that sound familiar? Well, again, we must ask, why just those notes in that particular order? Research seems to indicate that this exact constellation of two notes and its three-note variant is the same all over the world, wherever children tease each other, on every continent and in every culture. In short, we may have here a clear case of a musico-linguistic universal, and one which can be identified and explained in a non-vacuous way. I want to take a little time to do this carefully, because in the explanation lies the key to musical universality in general, the answer to the question, why just those notes, and eventually to the question, why those notes in Mozart, and why those notes in Copland, or in Schoenberg, or whoever. And in having an answer, we musicians have a singular advantage over the linguists who ask their question, why just those sounds in human speech? And they seek their answers by constructing a very complex hypothesis, which is still very much in the working stage, subject to proof or disproof, amplification or derision. But we musicians are luckier. We have the built-in, preordained universal known as the harmonic series. And to those of you who know all about the harmonic series, I beg your indulgence for a few minutes so that I can sketch it out for those who don't. This acoustical phenomenon called the harmonic series or overtone series is not hard to understand if you remember the basic high school fact that all sounds are produced by vibrating bodies which send out waves. Now, if such a vibrating body is irregularly constituted, like this floor or this piano, it will emit waves which are irregular, and our ears will perceive them as noise. Ow. But if the source of vibration is of a consistent structure, like any one of the strings in this piano, it will emit regular waves, and we hear them as a musical tone. Of course, the source doesn't have to be a string. It can be a column of air, as in a clarinet, or a column of steel as in a tubular bell, or a stretched animal hide as in a kettle drum. But whatever it is, it produces what's called energy in vibratory motion. That's the official language. By being beaten, blown, plucked, struck, or frictionized with a bow. Now let's settle for a piano string. Let's say this one, which is of a particular length, tension, thickness, and density, and when struck by its hammer, produces sound waves at a frequency of 132 vibrations per second, and is known to the world as the note C. Now comes the interesting part. If I sit at the piano and play that low C, you may think you're hearing only that one tone, a dark, rich bass note. But you're not. You are simultaneously hearing a whole series of higher tones that are sounding at the same time. And these are arranged in an order preordained by nature and ruled by universal physical laws. And if this is news to you, I hope it's good news. Because all these upper notes, of which you may be unaware, result from a phenomenon of nature whereby any sound-producing source, or I should say pitch-producing source, such as this piano string, vibrates not only as the whole string in all its whatever-inch glory, sounding that low C, but also in fractional segments of that string, each vibrating separately. It's as though the string were infinitely divisible into two halves, into three-thirds, four-quarters, and so on. And the smaller those segments are, the faster they vibrate, producing higher and higher frequencies, and therefore higher and higher tones, overtones, or harmonics, as they're sometimes called. Now, these overtones, or harmonics, are all sounding together with the fundamental sound of the full string. And this is the basic principle by which the entire harmonic series is generated, starting on any fundamental tone. Now, if you already knew all that from high school physics, you will also know that these overtones are naturally less apparent to the ear than the fundamental, which is in this case low C. And in fact, they sound more and more faintly as they go higher. Now, any note I strike will contain its own series of overtones. But the lower the note I strike, the more abundantly audible will be its harmonic series, which accounts in part for the comparative richness of this low C. Now remember, I spoke of a preordained order in which the overtones appear. Let's see if I can make you actually hear those overtones in that order. The first overtone of the series, according to the laws of physics, has to be exactly an octave higher than the fundamental C we've been hearing. In other words, it's going to be this C, an octave higher. Now, if I silently press down the key of this higher C and hold it so that the string is free to vibrate, and then abruptly strike the fundamental C, an octave lower, what do you hear? You are clearly hearing the first overtone vibrating sympathetically an octave above its fundamental. I hope you heard it, did you? Listen again. Clear as a bell. So obviously this upper C is an integral part of the C an octave below. It's a built-in harmonic sounded by the two halves of that lower string vibrating independently. The next overtone of this preordained order results from that same fundamental string vibrating in three parts. And this one will be the first different overtone. That is the first one you'll hear other than a C. And it's going to be a G, this G. And now let's repeat our experiment. I press this new one down silently, and then again strike the fundamental C. What do we hear now? That G, right? A new tone, again clear as a bell. You want to hear it again? Now we've just reached a very significant point. Have you noticed that the fundamental tone and its first overtone are really the same note, C, but an octave apart? But this new overtone, G, is a fifth away from C. So we now have two different tones. And once they are established in our ears, we are in possession of the key to the whole tonal system, a system based on the concept of tonic and dominant. Tonic and dominant. This C represents the idea of tonic, which has the function of establishing the tonal center of any given key. And the function of the dominant is to aid and abet in the establishment of that tonality through a special relationship it enjoys with the tonic, owing to their proximity in the harmonic series. But more of that later. Right now, on to the next overtone, which is again a C, a fourth higher than the G we just heard. Shall we repeat the experiment? I press it down silently. There it is. You hear it? I do it again. Now the next one is again a new pitch, this time a third higher than its predecessor. Notice that the intervals are getting progressively smaller as we ascend the series. It began with an octave, and then a fifth, and then a fourth, and then now a third. And this new overtone will be this note, E. Listen. It's a bit fainter, but it's there for all to hear. Shall I try it again? Hear it way back there? One last time. Clear. And there you have the first four overtones of the series. The fundamental plus one, two, three, four. Three of which are different pitches. Those three. Now it must be obvious to you that these three notes, rearranged in scalar order, constitute what is known as the major triad, which is the very nucleus, the cornerstone of most of the music we hear from day to day, whether it's a symphony or a hymn or a blues. And this triad with its tonic-dominant relationship plus the third sandwiched in between, this triad is the foundation of Western tonal music as it is developed over the last three centuries or so, along with the development of our Western culture in general. And let's not make the mistake so many people make of regarding this triad as a basic universal. That's a misapprehension that's far too common, in that it fails to recognize that our Occidental culture is only one of many world cultures, in spite of its current prevalence and worldwide influence, and in spite of the fact that it thinks it's the only important culture. A perfect example of this, in fact, of this misconception, arises with the very next overtone in the series, which is a stranger to Western tonal culture. In fact, this next overtone doesn't even appear on the piano, which means I can't demonstrate it for you as I have all the preceding ones. More exactly stated, it is not to be found on the piano in its natural, pure form as it derives by physical law from that fundamental C string. Let me digress for a moment to tell you why. You see, this piano, like all keyboard instruments, is a tempered instrument, which means simply that its notes have been tempered or tampered with. I don't mean a joke by that. I just mean to clarify the word. So that each one of them, each one of these notes, can serve its function in all 12 keys at once. This readjustment in tuning became inevitable when music reached its tonal adulthood around 1700. And found that it didn't have to remain in one key from the beginning to the end of a piece, but could modulate from one key to another in the course of it. But the notes deriving naturally from the harmonic series will work in only one key at a time. Do you follow that? One key at a time. That is, what's in tune in one key is likely to be out of tune in another. Would you believe that if this piano were to encompass only natural, untempered tones, this single octave space would have to contain 77 different keys? Well, you can understand that a compromise had to be made somewhere. And that somewhere was the moment in history when the rapid development of tonal harmony coincided with the equally rapid development of keyboard instruments with their fixed, unchangeable tones. And that's how the tempered clavichord came to be, to say nothing of this Baldwin Grand. And that's why I can't play you this next overture. But actually, if we approach it pianistically in our ascent of the harmonic series, we find it somewhere around here, lying in the crack between this B flat and this A. It's one of those blue notes. Now that blue note can be construed by the human ear as either the higher version of the note, B flat, or the lower version, A. In either case, it requires a little push up or down to be accommodated on a piano. But whichever way we construe it, it becomes our newest overtone. So we are now equipped with four different overtones, the C plus the G plus the E plus that blue note, that dubious A. Or if we rearrange them in scalar order, C, E, G, and sort of A. And here we hit a real musicolinguistic universal, because now we can understand and explain that famous worldwide teasing chant. Na, 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 ollie, ollie, I'm free. Because all it is a constellation of those first four different overtones with the tonic omitted, or rather implied. You see, this tonic C, which is the same note as the fundamental C, is heard in the mind's ear, and only the three new overtones are sung. And so these three universal notes are handed to us by nature on a silver platter. But why are they in this different order? Because that's the very order in which they appear in the harmonic series. G, E, and sort of A. And Q, E, D. Now this is a substantive universal, the sort of thing linguists hunger for, but the likes of which are simply not available to them. Indeed, as we ascend further in our harmonic series, more and more fascinating and incontrovertible universals keep appearing. For instance, this next new overtone is this one, that is the next new overtone, is this one, D. And so we now have five different tones to play with, which we again put into scalar order. And presto, a new universal is given us, the five note or pentatonic scale. Now, because of that dubious last note, the scale can take either of two forms, one culminating in B flat and the other culminating in A. Now, let's opt for the second of these, the lower one, which is by far the most common of the two. Now, this is humanity's favorite pentatonic scale. And by the way, this is the scale you can find so easily on your own piano by playing only the black notes. In fact, the universality of this scale is so well known that I'm sure you could give me examples of it from all corners of the earth, as from Scotland. Pure pentatonic. Or from China. Or from Africa. From American Indian cultures, and from East Indian cultures, and from Central and South America, and Australia and Finland, and, well, that's a true musicolinguistic universal. But let's be careful about making linguistic analogies. We could conceivably equate a fundamental tone, such as this C, with the basic morpheme ma, which we discovered before, and then extend the parallel by equating the overtones of that fundamental C with a set of words evolving from that ma syllable. Maybe, it's all still speculation. But what appears to be much more convincing is the analogy between Chomsky's innate grammatical competence and the innate musical grammatical competence which we may all possess universally, that is, our inbuilt capacity to construe those naturally serialized overtones and to construe them in different ways, just as the various cultures of the world may have construed basic monogenetic materials and constructed out of them thousands of particular grammars or languages, all different from one another. Analogously, varied human cultures can construe this pentatonic scale in different ways, depending, for example, on which of the five notes is taken to be the tonal center. For example, this one, that's one way. Or this one. You see how it makes it a whole different pentatonic, but they're the same five notes. Or this one, same five notes again, but a different scale. And there is always that blue note to be considered. If the ear construes it as the upper B flat instead of the lower A, it will give us a whole other pentatonic scale, which produces some beautiful African music. And there are even more complex processes, which we won't go into, but which account for the existence of the highly differentiated Japanese pentatonic scale. Does that sound familiar? Or the unique pentatonic of Balinese music. But enough of pentatonics. I think we've seen enough of the way the harmonic series operates to recognize the fact that as we ascend the series, always finding new tones to be added, to be added to our collection, we can eventually account for 6 and 7 note scales, including Greek modes and church modes, and the diatonic scales, both major and minor, and eventually all 12 tones of our so-called chromatic scale, which is, of course, due to the miracle of tempering. We get those 12 equidistant tones. And you may well ask, why just 12 tones? Patience, you'll find out in a minute. But even these 12 tones don't exhaust the potential of the harmonic series. The upper reaches of the series continue to furnish us with intervals even smaller than the half tones that make up our chromatic scale. Intervals such as quarter tones, or even thirds and fifths of tones, all of which still inhabit areas of experimentation and electronic research. To say nothing of microtones, which are such an essential part of so much Oriental music. But the overriding fact that emerges from all this is that all music, whether pop, folk, symphonic, modal, tonal, atonal, polytonal, microtonal, well-tempered or ill-tempered, music from the distant past or the imminent future, all of it has a common origin in the universal phenomenon of the harmonic series. And that is our case for musical monogenesis. But is it necessarily a case for universality? Think. What about those Hindu ragas that so many people find difficult to comprehend? Well, I suggest a simple answer in the light of our linguistic analogies. Just as the grammars of human languages, even mutually unintelligible ones, may have sprung from the same monogenetic sources, so in the same way, highly varied musical tongues, which are also strangers to one another, can be said to have developed out of their common origins. In purely phonological terms, these tongues are tonal languages that have developed out of a universal, naturally ordered tonal structure. Now, I trust you realize that all this has been enormously compressed and undocumented by historical musical examples, because that would take all night. But this is not a linguistics course, nor is it a history of music course. What we're trying for is a very high overview of musical development in terms of a vocabulary constantly being enriched by more and more remote and chromatic overtones. It's as if we could see the whole of music developing from prehistory to the present in 2 minutes. Now let's again pretend we're hominids and that the smash hit of the moment is, let's say, Fair Harvard. Here we are in our hominid hut, crooning, Fair Harvard, and now maybe our wives and maybe our prepubescent sons join in, and automatically we're singing not in unison, but in octaves, since men's and women's voices are naturally an octave apart. And with blessing surrender thee. Now that octave interval, I wish I could sing an octave so I could really show you what I mean. But that octave interval happens to be the first interval of the harmonic series, as you remember, right? Okay, now centuries pass, and the next interval of the harmonic series is assimilated by humanity, namely the fifth. And now we can be singing this. By those festival rites and letters. Now, of course, this little change brings us forward a mere 10 million years into the 10th century AD and into a fairly sophisticated musical culture. But now we admit the next interval of the series, the fourth, and now we can mix intervals of the octave and the fifth and the fourth. Well, that's beginning to sound like polyphony. And again comes a great leap as music absorbs the next overtone, the third, and just listen to the difference. It's a whole new music, richer, mellower, with a new coloristic warmth. And as we know, this new interval of the third, because I like the older sound better, but anyway, as we know, this new interval of the third introduces into music the phenomenon of the triad, so that now Fair Harvard can begin to sound more like its Victorian self. Is born what we now call tonal music, a stable tonal language firmly rooted in the basic notes of the harmonic series, the fundamental and its first different overtone, the fifth, now and forevermore to be known as the tonic and the dominant. And that fifth interval really does dominate, because once this tonic-dominant relationship is established, it's a field day for composers. There can now be fifths of fifths of fifths of fifths, each one of them a new tonic producing a new dominant, a whole circle of fifths, 12 of them in fact, always winding up with the starting tone, whether proceeding upwards, let's say from the low C, G, D, A, E, B, F sharp, C sharp, G sharp, D sharp, B flat, F, C. That's again C, believe it or not. Or proceeding downward, starting from that, C, F, B flat, E flat, A flat, D flat, E flat, G. Oh, I'm sorry. C, back to C. That's a circle of 12 fifths, and that's the answer I promised you. That's how we get the 12 different tones of our chromatic scale. In other words, if you take all those 12 of the circle of fifths and put them together in scale order, you'll get this. And what's more, those 12 notes generate a circle of 12 keys through which, thanks to the perfecting of the temperate system, composers can now go freewheeling at their own chromatic pleasure. Now this means that ultimately Fair Harvard can sound like this. That's chromatic porridge. And in our own century, it's going to become goulash. How does music contain this loose, runny chromaticism? by the basic principle of diatonicism, that stable relationship of tonics and dominants, subdominants and supertonics, and new dominants and new tonics. And we can now modulate as freely as we want, as chromatically as we want, and still have complete tonal control. This great system of tonal controls was perfected and codified by Bach, Johann Sebastian Bach, whose genius was to balance so delicately and so justly these two forces of chromaticism and diatonicism, forces that were equally powerful and presumably contradictory in nature. Now, this point of delicate balance is like the still center in the stormy flux of musical history, a condition of such stability that it was able to continue without remarkable changes for almost a century. And this roughly 100 years became a golden age. Now, this is not to say that there weren't drastic changes in style and form during those 100 years. Because after all, this golden age saw the emergence of a whole new Rococo style, to say nothing of the phenomenal rise of sonata form in the hands of such giants as Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach and Haydn and Mozart and Beethoven himself. But these changes are syntactic and semantic changes, which we'll be examining and enjoying in future lectures. Right now, we're limiting our investigation to phonology, and in these terms, we can see the peak attained by Bach continuing as a kind of plateau, level and lofty, right into the music of Beethoven. Now, at this point, I would like to invite you to listen with me to one of the supreme examples of this golden age, Mozart's G minor symphony, a work of utmost passion, utterly controlled, and of free chromaticism, elegantly contained. I'll try to prepare you a bit, somewhat, with a few illustrations of this control and containment so that you can hear the symphony, hopefully with fresh phonological ears. And remember, what we're looking for is the wonderfully creative ways in which chromatic flexibility can be systematically contained within the framework of tonic-dominant relationships. It's a curious thing, and a crucial one, that through this perfect combination of opposites, chromaticism and diatonicism, there is distilled the essence of ambiguity of all things. Now, this word ambiguity may seem the most unlikely word to use in speaking of a golden age composer like Mozart, a master of clarity and precision. But ambiguity has always inhabited musical art, indeed all the arts, because it is one of art's most potent aesthetic functions. The more ambiguous, the more expressive, up to a certain point. Of course, there's a limit, which we're going to run into in the course of these lectures, and we're going to run into a state of such increased ambiguity that problems of musical clarity are bound to arise, and that's when we'll be confronted head-on by Ives' unanswered question, whither? And meanwhile, we're still in the golden age, with ambiguity classically contained in the Augustan balances and proportions inherent in this Mozart symphony. But let's look at it very briefly. You all remember the opening, the first movement. Now, this whole section moves quite easily and diatonically from its G minor tonic to its first cadence, which is, naturally enough, on the dominant. And just as easily slipping back into the tonic. Back we are. Now, of course, you remember that this tonic-dominant relationship arises from the adjacency of the fundamental tone, in this case G, with its first overtone, that basic interval of the fifth. And from there, the music proceeds by a circle of fifths, a downward circle of fifths, to its relative major, B flat. which is exactly where it's supposed to be for the appearance of the second thematic section. But notice that Mozart's theme is already chromatically formed, and it gets more so as it goes on, and even more so when it repeats. What's this? A whole new key, A flat major. Sudden new key, unrelated to either B flat or G minor. How did we get here? By the well-known circle of fifths. Do you hear those stable, consecutive fifths striding inexorably from dominant to tonic in the bass? Dominant, tonic, dominant, tonic, dominant, tonic. While above, the melodic line descends by chromatic half steps into the nether regions of A flat major. There's that classical balance we were talking about. Chromatic wandering on the top, but firmly supported by the tonic dominant structure underneath. And you see now what I meant by the beauty of ambiguity. It's the combination of those two contradictory forces, chromaticism and diatonicism, operating at the same time that makes this passage so expressive. So, we're in the midst of a chromatic adventure, right? How do we get out of this strange A-flat territory? By a simple chromatic shift, like side-slipping on skis. And there we are, back safely in B-flat major, where we belong. Now, if you could follow that, you can follow any number of similar adventures. For instance, the way Mozart starts his development section. He's established us firmly in B-flat major. But no! Off he goes on another chromatic adventure, which lands us in the impossible key of F sharp minor. Now, this was done by absolute whim, arbitrarily. It's a bit of chromatic acrobatics, if you will, startling us into a development section, which is just what a development section should be, startling new looks at old material. But eventually, he must get us back to a recapitulation in G minor, the original home soil. And he's completely free to make this journey as chromatically as he wishes. His fantasy is totally released. It's a development section. It's freewheeling time. But even here, the basic diatonic laws contain and control that freewheeling passion and fantasy. And all by those progressions of fifths, the dominant seeking its tonic, and each tonic turning into a dominant seeking its tonic, and that turning into a dominant seeking its own tonic over and over again. We were in F sharp minor, right? Now through a sequence of such progressions, he changes that F sharp tonality from a tonic function to a dominant function, which is seeking its tonic B natural. And here we are. There's B natural. But now B natural is a dominant seeking its tonic E. And so into E we go. And by the same chain of fifths, E seeks A. That's A. And then A seeks D. D. And so on through the circle until we're finally led back home to G minor. But even this lead-in to the home key is chromatically written. Firmly held in place, of course, by a dominant pedal. Listen to this creepy, crawly chromaticism. And we're back to our oh so gratifying and welcome recapitulation in G minor. Now, I must point out that these adventures are much more complex and subtle than I've made them sound. The procedure is not always exactly by fifths, and there are twists and turns which would take hours to describe accurately, even to a classroom of Harvard music students. The best I can do is to give you some insight into this marvel of ambiguity, the diatonic containment of chromaticism, so that when you hear, for instance, in the second movement, this extraordinary chromatic passage, you can also be aware of the strong diatonic underpinnings, those fifths, again, striding inexorably from tonic to dominant. See if you can hear them. Even in the third movement, the minuet, which is extremely diatonic, it's hardly chromatic at all. Mozart can't resist, just before the end, one of his charming chromatic excursions. But instantly, it all writes itself in a classical dominant tonic cadence. But the most breathtaking chromatic trip of all occurs in the final movement, which begins, as you remember, innocent enough and tonally not too eventful throughout the whole exposition. But then again comes the development section, and all hell breaks loose. You realize that that wild atonal sounding passage contains every one of the 12 chromatic tones except the tonic G. What an inspired idea! All the notes except the tonic. It could easily pass for 20th century music if we didn't already know it was Mozart. But even that explosion of chromaticism is explainable in terms of the circle of fifths. Not that I dream of burdening you with it, but take my word for it, that outburst of chromatic rage is classically contained, and so is the climax of this development section, which finds itself suddenly in the key of, it's not so sudden, in the key of C sharp minor. C sharp minor, which is as far away as you can get from the home key of G minor. Sounds pretty remote, doesn't it? And again, believe me, all these phonological arrivals and departures to and from the most distantly related areas operate in the smoothest, most Mozartian way under perfect diatonic control. Well, what does this all add up to? Now let's find out by hearing the whole work as performed on film by the Boston Symphony Orchestra, and I hope we'll be listening to it with fresh phonological ears. What a piece. Now, last night, at the first presentation of this lecture, the Harvard Square Theater, this performance of the Mozart Symphony was interrupted in the middle of the first movement by a bomb scare. And we all had to go out into the street, nobody knowing whether we were going to come back and resume or not, and wait for almost an hour until we had word that the police had cleared the whole theater. And during that wait, I must say that I was sick at heart and overcome by despair, because why had I been talking my guts out for an hour and a half on human brotherhood and universality, only to have this kind of despicable disproof of human brotherhood thrown in our faces? But when I came back, and we all came back, and so many of the audience did come back, to my amazement, and listened from the beginning again through to the end of this symphony, I must say that my faith was restored and doubled, not only by this incredible piece of music, which I guess if one had to point to a work that symbolized in itself the essence of the whole Faustian experience of man since the Renaissance, this would be it. But also because of the number of the audience that waited it out and came back and listened to it, terribly moved. Of course, I wouldn't have been so upset if the interruption had come during my talk, but to interrupt Mozart, to interrupt that extraordinary wholeness and continuity, that entity which is this work, was the greatest insult of all. But as I say, my faith was restored. Just to hear it, and just to hear it with those people and through them. So I feel even more confident of what I was trying to say in the beginning than I had when I wrote it. Just a short word now about our subject next time, which will be syntax. Do you remember the second of the three linguistic departments? Musical and linguistic syntax, in which we'll be examining the actual formations of these phonological elements we've been discussing this time. And then we'll be ready to understand the semantic problems of music from Mozart to the present, and hopefully come closer and closer to understanding and maybe even answering Ives' unanswered question. Thank you.